fun. Who am I that the highest king would look upon? I was lost, but he brought me in his love for me. His love for me. Sunsets free, all is
seated.
It is great to be together to worship our God today. Welcome to Quaker Gap Baptist Church. Glad that you are here so we can worship Him together. And we praise God for the opportunity to just raise our voices as one and to be together in the Father's house as we just sang. There are some announcements to make this morning, so let me share those with you. First of all, I want you to know that our youth are going to be meeting on Wednesday night from 6 to 8, starting in the youth room, and then having a devotion there and heading out to Dario. So that's this Sunday or Wednesday night, 6 to 8, from the youth room to the Dario and back home again. Our youth are all invited to that. As well, there are some children's activities to report. First of all, this Wednesday evening, our children, kids entering K through 6th grade, are invited to Rodney and Joyce Proctor's house for a pizza and pool party. That is 2173 Hampton Road. If you need that information, call the church office. But we're going to have a pizza and pool party at Rodney and Joyce's house this Wednesday from 6 to 8 for all of our kids entering K to 6th grade. And I hope that you can be a part of that. Also want to remind you that on Sunday, August 29th, we are having our church-wide Back to Church Bash, which is for everyone. And we're going to have a hot dog lunch following our morning service a couple weeks from today. Robert White is going to be with us. He is an entertainer, a magician, a comedian. And in addition to that, we'll have a big blow-up slide for all of our kids, small and large, to slide down. And just have a great time of fellowship together after our service on Sunday, August 29th. Also on that day, if you think of it, could you bring some school supplies with you for us to donate to the Seeds of Hope campers so that they'll have school supplies ready for them as they begin this new school year? So that is on Sunday, August 29th, as you go out to buy school supplies for your kids. Just buy a couple extra things and bring them with you on that day. This Saturday, you are invited to help up at the Habitat House. And we're going to be meeting at the church at 8 o'clock. And, or you can meet at the job site at 8:30. And this is for anyone 16 years of age or older. Lunch is going to be provided. So if you plan on being there, please let Dennis Ruff know that you are going to be a part of that. So that's this coming Saturday. Meeting at 8 at the church or 8:30 at the job site. Also want to let you know that there is no choir or worship band this week. So those are going to be canceled for another week as all of the students begin to arrive at Wake Forest. And James is going to be a little busy this week, understand. So we'll just meet again in a couple of weeks. And I think that does it for the announcements. There is one other thing. There are signups at takethemameal.com. To bring meals to John and Tiffany Haynes during this time. And if you'd like to go to takethemameal.com, call the church office because I don't have all the details here. You should have gotten an email and take a look at that and please sign up to bring them a meal. Also, if you know that's just not the thing that you do, you could buy a gift certificate to a local restaurant or something like that. And bring by the church office, and we'll make sure that they get that. That's another way that you can be of service to them during this time in their lives. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we welcome your presence here today. Every word that we sing is lifted up in your honor to your praise and glory. Father, I pray that we might have fellowship with you as a church family today. We pray for those who can't be with us, those who are traveling, getting in their last week away. We just pray, Father, that you would be with them during this time. Lord, we especially are praying for our parents of college students as they have gone off to school, will be starting soon, especially those who have first-time college students. We just pray, Lord, for your mercy and grace for them. And we just pray, Father, that this would be a safe and productive school year for all of our college students. Again, we're thankful, Lord, for your presence and pray that, Lord, as we lift our voices together, Lord, that you would receive the praise that comes from our hearts. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
I've told my choir many times that the hymns that we sing are so important because the things that we know and learn about God, about the Holy Spirit, about Christ, 90% of it is learned from the hymns that we sing, from the music that we listen to. And so in my heart, I have a desire to continue learning the hymns, to continue to talk about the hymns, and to have us sing them from time to time. This hymn this morning, though, is one that will probably be more familiar to some of our life experienced folks. Okay? So, see how I did that? So, Oh Happy Day That Fixed My Choice, 439 in your hymn book. Now, I got to tell you a little bit something about this. Why is this hymn important to this congregation? Well, I'll tell you. I'm so glad you asked. Years ago, baptisms were held at the camp retreat, which is right down here off the Sizemore Road. Does anyone remember where that is? You don't have to raise your hand. Some do. Camp Retreat, down off the Sizemore Road, there was a pond, and they would have baptisms there at that pond. And when they would have a baptism, what would they do? Judy, they would sing this hymn, wouldn't they? Oh, happy day. So we're going to stand and sing this hymn, Oh Happy Day That Fixed My Choice. I will lead us strongly if you're not familiar with it, so you will be by the time we get to the end of it. Let's stand together.
Let's take our Bibles and turn to Isaiah chapter 6. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 8 of Isaiah chapter 6. Have you ever wondered what would happen if you were to catch a glimpse of God? It's precisely what happens to Isaiah here in this passage of Scripture. And it changed his life. Isaiah chapter 6, reading verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar, and with it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you today for this gathering that we can come together with brothers and sisters in Christ and worship your name and catch a glimpse of who you are. So, Father, I pray that you would speak to us through your word, through our singing together, Lord, that you would be blessed. Father, that you would draw us together into fellowship with one another and with you. And, Father, give us a fresh vision of who you are. And, Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ here, Lord, that you would help us to grow. Father, that we would experience strength in our spiritual lives, as well as health in every area of life. And we do pray, Lord, that as we begin a new school year, Father, that you would be with us all as a church family. Father, that you would prepare us for all of our responsibilities as far as our children's ministry and our Sunday school and all of these areas of church are concerned as we begin to, again, hand out meals to our community as we have opportunity, Lord, to be a blessing to those around us. I pray, Father, that you would prepare us for that, that you would prepare us physically, but more importantly, that you would prepare us spiritually. Father, that you might find us on our knees, asking for your strength, asking, Lord, that you would use us. Father, that our work would not be in vain, but that it would be truly a work of the Holy Spirit and not a work done in the flesh. So, Lord, we thank you today for the opportunity to be together and to open your word. And, Lord, use this time to speak to us. Be with those who are sick, those who need healing, Lord. We trust in you to walk with them on this journey. For those who are traveling, we pray, Lord, for your mercies. Bring them home safely. We look forward to their presence again with us in worship. And, Father, we pray for any who might have found discouragement during this time. Lord, that you would lift them up. Father, that you, as you say in your word, would be the lifter of our heads, that you would be our encouragement. Father, that we would turn to you during these times and find nothing but love and joy and peace. So, Father, walk with us now through the rest of this service. Speak to our hearts, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Receive the food of your home. plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Teach us, Lord, full obedience, holy reverence, true humility. Test our thoughts and our attitudes in the radiance of your purity. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let their truth prevail over
I think it probably goes without saying that the last year and a half has not been easy for anyone. Those with health concerns have had to be very, very careful. Those with elderly loved ones have been cautious. Healthcare workers have had to face stress every day at work, and have spent many days at risk on the front lines. And anyone who has had to make decisions that affect others has felt the weight of those decisions. Parents of school children, college students keeping an eye on their school's expectations, workers that have had to work from home. And as a result of the stress of all of this, everybody seems to be on edge like never before. Emotions are raw, anger is right there on the surface. Social media has turned into a swamp. And so if you want to keep the peace these days, here are some things that you should never bring up, right? Masks, just don't even talk about it. Vaccines, whether you've had it or not, just don't talk about it. election fraud, not a good topic to bring up in polite conversation. Racism, politics, masks, vaccines. Just don't go there, right? Unless you're the type of person that enjoys dropping a match into a pool of gasoline, just don't even go there. And as a result of all of this stress that we've been living with, our health has been paying a price. I don't know if you realize that, but there is another pandemic that is occurring these days that nobody has been talking about. Our wellness as human beings has taken a hit. And to illustrate what I'm talking about, I've come up with a Venn diagram. Some of you know what a Venn diagram is. It's just circles that kind of overlap. And that's what we've got here, three circles that overlap. Took me a little bit of time to put this one together. But don't feel like you have to write all this down all of a sudden, because I've actually put this at the bottom of the front page of our webpage. So if you go to quakergap.info, at the very bottom of our homepage, there is this diagram so that you can have a closer look at it yourself. And you will see that there are three major aspects of your life and your health that I'm highlighting: your body, your mind, and your spirit. And that in the very center, at the overlap of a healthy body, mind, and spirit, there is wellness. So that's the picture. We can go into the details a little more. Let's take a quick look at these individual parts. First of all, your physical health matters. It matters to God. In 1 Samuel chapter 25, verse 6, David sends words of greetings and blessing to Nabal. And he says to the 10 men that he sent there, "Go up to Nabal at Carmel and greet him in my name. Say to him, 'Long life to you, good health to you and your household, and good health to all that is yours.'" And the word for good health is actually the word shalom in Hebrew language, which means peace. But you know, it's not just peace of mind, it's peace of heart, it's peace of body, it's wellness. And so it is understood throughout Scripture that long life and good health is a blessing. It's a blessing from God. It's a reason for rejoicing if you're experiencing that. And I don't know about you, but this hasn't been the best year for me, physically speaking. I'm just now getting back into trying to become healthier, a healthier rhythm of diet and exercise. Because the gyms were all closed and stress levels were high, and carbs were abundant. They were everywhere. And my family doctor, when I went to visit him recently, he said this is something that he has been seeing in many folks. And I don't know whether he was just trying to make me feel good, to say, look, you know, you're just like everybody else. But that's what he told me. He said physical health has been a hard thing to maintain in the last year and a half due to everything that's taken place. But physical health wasn't the only thing that has taken a hit. This has not been a good period of time for mental health either. Some of you know what I mean. We human beings are not very good at change. We're not very good with our schedules and our lives being interrupted. And we've been forced to live with a whole lot of it lately. And just when it feels like things are becoming normal again, then we get variants and media reports and more restrictions and more drama and more anxiety. And there's a tendency for us to fall into depression as a result of everything that we've experienced. You know, your mind, just like your body, also matters to the Lord. Psalm 139:23, David prays. He says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts." You know, if the Lord keeps track of all of our anxious thoughts, then his computers needed a storage upgrade this year, I think. But fortunately, God, we know, is omniscient and never runs out of memory. And so he cares about our thoughts. He knows each and every one of our thoughts. And his shoulders are broad enough to take on every single one of our burdens without any stress to himself at all. We just have a hard time learning how not to try to handle everything by ourselves. We say, I can handle this, God. I've got this. I don't need to involve you. So this Venn diagram indicates that there is overlap. There is a connection between your body and your mind. And you know this to be the case, because an unhealthy body has a tendency to shake you up mentally. Right? That it affects your self-esteem. Your physical weakness and poor physical fitness affects your thinking. And it creates even more worry and anxiety and stress. Additionally, an unhealthy mind can drag you down physically. What happens when you experience stress and anxiety in your life? You reach for ice cream, right? Or potato chips, or Big Macs, or Taco Bell, whatever is convenient. Or worse, cigarettes, alcohol. There are other ways that we choose to try and numb what's happening in our mind. And I want to encourage you, if this year and a half has been a negative impact on your physical and your mental health, please, please make an appointment with your doctor. You know, get your blood checked. See where you are physically. Develop some sort of an exercise regimen. Or see a therapist if it's something that's happening in your mind. Or a good Christian counselor, or just a good friend, someone that you can unload some of that stress on, that you can share with. At the intersection of the mind and the body in this Venn diagram, I've given you three examples of some disciplines that you can practice that will help you to promote a healthy connection between your body and your mind. That is to exercise, to walk, to run, to ride your bicycle, whatever it is you do. To exercise is good for your mind and your body. To sleep, try to get 8 hours of sleep a night. If you can manage that, sleep is good for both your mind and your body. And then to learn, you know, learning, opening a good book and reading, taking some online classes, spending some time educating yourself in something that, you know, you have an interest in. It's good for your mind and your body. So now we can't stop there, though. We can't stop with just the mind and the body. This is what the world does. You are more than a brain walking around with a body. There's much more to you than just that. You also have a spirit. You have a spirit. And your spiritual life is just as important as the others. Although we focus mostly on our body and our mind, our spirit is just as important. Maybe more important because it gets neglected. So we're going to focus on the spiritual life for a number of weeks beginning today. Because this is the place to do that. In God's house with God's people, looking at God's word. This is where we learn about the spiritual aspect of our life. We can learn about our bodies and our minds from what the word tells us, but I think the thing that God would have us to concentrate on is our spiritual health. Why? Because I believe that this year and a half has not just impacted our health physically and mentally and emotionally, it has impacted us spiritually too. I know it has for me. Remember, all of these things are connected. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27 highlights this spiritual aspect of our lives. It says, the human spirit is the lamp of the Lord that sheds light on one's inmost being. So imagine that your spirit is sort of like a window through which the lamp and the light of God shines into your inmost being. Now, what happens if that window is covered with all sorts of crud and fingerprints and dirt? It's not been taken care of. Well, the light of the Lord doesn't shine as brightly on your inmost being. You start to feel alone, disconnected Your relationship to God is not what it should be if the light of God is not shining in as it should be. We need to be concerned for our spiritual health so that the light of God can shine brightly into our inmost being. The Spirit is that place within us where we have communion with God. And when we suffer spiritually, we suffer as a whole person. And I don't care if you are a physical specimen, a strong man. I don't care if you run marathons. And in addition to that, you have a perfect, sharp IQ with all sorts of diplomas and degrees to show for it. I don't care if you're physically and mentally perfect. If you are spiritually weak, you are not as well as you think you are. As a complete person, you just aren't, can't possibly be well. There are two times in the book of Luke where the writer, Luke, describes the development of Jesus as a child when he is entering adolescence. And I want you to notice the elements of his growth that are used in these verses. So we're looking at the very center of that Venn diagram where it says wellness. That's where these verses are listed. What does wellness look like? Well, Luke tells us what wellness looked like in the life of Jesus as he was maturing. Luke chapter 2, verse 40 says, "And the child grew and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was on him." I hope you see what I see in those verses. He became strong. That's his body, his physical strength. He was filled with wisdom. That's his knowledge, his education, his mind, his mental state. And the grace of God was on him. That spiritual growth that this description of Jesus given to us by Luke demonstrates: spiritual, mental, and physical health. Luke chapter 2, verse 52, a little bit later in that same chapter, Luke says, "And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature, mind and body, and in favor with God and man." In favor with God, that spirit. He also says in favor with man. Now, I didn't say anything about relational health, right? I'm not in the mood to try to put together a four-circle Venn diagram. That might take me a while. But the way I look at it is this, okay? If your health is pictured in that Venn diagram that I showed you, body, mind, and spirit, and that is your wellness, I want you to imagine now that every single person in this room is one of those Venn diagrams, and that we all overlap with one another. We all overlap with one another. That's fellowship in the body of Christ. And that is what it means to have favor with God and man. And what happens is this, folks. If one of us is unhealthy spiritually, in mind or in body, it has a tendency to drag down the rest of us. Praise God, the other is true as well. So if there's someone who is strong in spirit and you spend time with them, if there's somebody who has good habits as far as their mind and their body are concerned, and you spend time with them, has a tendency to rub off on you as well. I'm challenged when I see someone who's in shape. I think, oh man, I need to get in shape too. But it's true spiritually as well. When I see someone who's walking with the Lord and they're strong in their prayer life, and they always have a word of encouragement or a verse of scripture to share with you, it encourages me, it lifts me up. We all can become healthy together as a community. So Jesus grew in body, mind, and spirit. So you see, the biblical estimate of personal wellness is growth and health in body, mind, and spirit. And to complete our Venn diagram, I'll give you some disciplines in order to encourage the other areas as well. For example, the mind-spirit connection, where they overlap. I've given you some disciplines that you can follow to study, right? To get into God's Word and to learn God's Word is something that is good for your mind and your spirit. To pray, to spend some time with the Lord. It doesn't have to be a long period of time on your knees. It could just be a few words of prayer while you're sitting at the stoplight. You know, it could just be throughout the course of the day, sending up arrow prayers to God as thoughts come into your heart and your mind. To pray is something that's good for your mind and your spirit, and to meditate. To take what God gives you and to mull it over. And to take some time to just think it through. This is good for your mind and your spirit. These are disciplines that will help you in those areas and in that overlap. And then, of course, there's the body spirit, which is a little different. We don't think about the connection between our body and our spirit very often. But there are some disciplines there that can help you in growth in that connection between your body and your spirit. For example, if you were to take the time to fast, fasting is something that you do in order to deprive your body of something that it craves, food, for example, or other things. But it trains your body as well as an opportunity for you to spiritually be connected to the Lord. In addition to that, resting. And by rest, I mean Sabbath rest. Okay? We already had sleeping, which is a connection between the mind and the body. But how about rest, which is a connection between the body and the spirit? When you take the time, for example, on a Sunday afternoon, to just allow yourself to rest in the Lord. And then also to serve. We serve God with our body and our spirit. We miss out if we only serve with our body. We need to serve God in spirit as well. So I understand that some of these things include the whole person. For example, I hope that when you go out to serve the Lord, for example, if you were to go this Saturday to help with Habitat, that would be actions that would be from your body, as you begin to nail in boards or put siding on a house or whatever it is they're doing there that day, sweeping the floors, washing the windows, whatever it is you do, there's something that you're doing bodily. You have to put your mind into that as well, because you're thinking about what you're doing. And in addition to that, I pray that your spirit's involved in that too, because you're saying, I'm doing this for the Lord, as unto the Lord. Our mind, our body, and our spirit are connected in ways that we don't even know. So what do? After a year and a half of fear and worry and concern and anger and change and relational loss, grief, physical neglect, church closings, physical disconnection, spiritual disconnection. What do after a year and a half of all of that? What do when you find that you are not as well as you should be? Or you're not as well as you know you once were? So maybe none of this has been the case for you. Maybe this hasn't affected you at all. Now, I remember early on when this whole pandemic thing started, I thought to myself, wow, this is going to be great. You know, there's going to be time now, you know, because there's a lot of responsibilities that we're not going to be able to participate in, which is going to give us more time for other things. And I got a little bit excited about that because, you know, the little introverted part of me said, I'm going to be able to read more and study more. I'm going to be able to spend more time in prayer and with the Lord. This is going to be great to be able to get away from people because I'm not allowed to be with people. This will be wonderful. And then I thought, you know, it's going to give me an opportunity to go up to the trails and to walk, experience nature, to get away from folks. It's going to give me an opportunity to eat healthy, to think about, you know, what I'm eating. I thought this could actually be good for my health as a person, this pandemic. And maybe you did okay with that. Maybe that's how it worked out for you. I confess, I didn't. It didn't happen that way for me. You know, everybody had the same idea about walking on those trails until they finally just closed Hanging Rock and all the state parks and said, nah, too many people. The Y had to close. As far as the time for reading and studying that I thought was going to be there, nope. Because everything I had to do in my work as a pastor to prepare for services took three times as long. Here I was thinking, I'm just going to have to preach to a camera and it'll be over. No, I have to edit it. I have to upload it. I have to get it done on time. And it just was three times as hard to do everything and to think through everything and to learn new skills. And then there was the decision making and the stress and the poor eating habits that came from that. And let's just say it didn't work out the way I thought it would. It worked out much differently than I thought it would. So here we are. Here we are, a year and a half later. What now? And not that it's completely over. I mean, we're still dealing with some of this stuff. But where do we begin? How do we start over? I find that if I'm going to improve my health in all three areas, I need to start somewhere. And the most effective place, I believe, to begin is in my spirit. I believe that if I begin with concentrating on my spiritual life and my spiritual health, it's like grabbing the spirit handle and lifting it up, and everything else will come with it. That's going to take some discipline and some work in the other areas. I'm not saying it's going to happen magically, but I am saying that if I'm going to start somewhere, it's going to be in my connection with the Almighty Living God. And if I can work on my spiritual health, the mind and the body will come along with it. So where does spiritual life begin? How do we tend to our spiritual health? So do you remember the passage that we read a little bit earlier? For Isaiah, where did it all begin for him? Where did his spiritual revival start? So look at Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 with me again. Isaiah says, I saw the Lord. I saw the Lord. And then he describes what he saw. The Lord is high and exalted and seated on a throne, and the train of his robe fills the entire temple. And that there are these angels, each with six wings, and they're covering their faces, their eyes from the glory of God, and they're covering their feet, perhaps out of shame to be before God. And they're flying with the other two wings, and they're calling out to one another in praise. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. And as they're singing their song and chanting back and forth, at the sound of those great voices, the whole temple is shaking. The doorposts and the thresholds are shaking. And the whole temple is filled with smoke. And this is what Isaiah sees. And we're just going to stop there for now. You know, we're going to move on through this passage as we go from week to week. But this week, I just want to stop there and say that Isaiah's spiritual renewal begins with a vision of God. He experiences God. He comes to know God in a new way. And I believe that our spiritual wellness also begins by knowing God. And it all flows from there. Everything that happens to Isaiah in that passage begins with his eyes being opened to who God is, and then everything flows from there. First, we look to the Lord, and we fill our hearts and our minds with his presence, and everything flows from there. So Isaiah sees the Lord in his vision, and what does he take away from it? Here's what Isaiah sees. First of all, he sees God's supremacy. What I mean by that is that God is in control, he is in charge, that God is on the throne, seated high on the throne, that there is no other power in this world like the power of God. God is supreme, he is over all, he is sovereign. God rules and reigns. It's the first thing he notices. He also notices about God, his presence. God's presence, his robe, fills the entire temple. The presence of God fills the entire earth. You cannot escape the presence of God. He is everywhere, all the time. You cannot find a place where God is not there. He is fully present. God is supreme in control over all, and he is fully present everywhere at once. Isaiah also saw God's glory as these angels sang about the glory of God. The whole earth is filled with his glory. They covered their eyes in order perhaps to not be blinded by the light of God's glory and his beauty and his majesty. In addition to the brightness, the glory of God, Isaiah saw God's holiness. As these beings cried out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." What were they saying? They were saying, look, God is unlike any other. There is no one like God. He is set apart. He is pure. He is beautiful. There is none like our God. He is holy. And then he noticed God's power. As everything began to shake, as the temple was filled with smoke, and the whole room began to tremble, it's a picture of the power of God. We all live at the behest, under the love, under the power of this God. So this is what he sees in his mind's eye, this vision that he gets of God. God is supreme. He rules. He is present everywhere at all times. There's nowhere to hide from him. His glory is bright. It shines. It's beautiful. He's holy. He is set apart and pure. There is none like him. And he is powerful. And he shakes everything with his presence. This beautiful picture of God that Isaiah receives. Now, we're going to talk later about what happens to Isaiah as a result of experiencing this vision from God. But what would happen to you if you experienced that vision from God? For now, just stop and look at the Lord. Just stop and look at the Lord in your spirit. Just concentrate on him. So I want to ask you to close your eyes. Just close your eyes for a few moments. And just concentrate on the Lord. See the exalted throne, high and lifted up. See the flowing, pure white robe that fills the temple. The flashes of lightning, the angels calling out to one another from across the room, holy, 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 unable to look at him, covering themselves before him. And I want you to just discover God's holiness and discover his glory and see it in your heart and in your mind there. Recognize this, that the road to your spiritual health and life begins when you know who God is. And when you simply worship him in awe of who he is. So, as your eyes are closed, when you see God, what do you see? What do you see when you imagine God? Now, do you see a burning bush like Moses? The God's voice calling out to you? Do you see an ark floating above the floodwaters? Salvation and rescue. What do you see when you see God? Do you see the prodigal son's father running in a ridiculous fashion, pulling up his robe, tears streaming down his face, his arms outstretched, ready to receive even the worst of sinners? Is that what you see when you imagine God? Or do you see Jesus nailed to a cross, blood flowing from his body, dying there in your place? Maybe he looks your way like he did to the thief on the cross and says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." What do you see when you imagine God? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6 says, He is one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Romans chapter 11, verse 36 says, For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. And 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 6 says, Yet for us there is but one God, the Father, from whom all things came and for whom we live. And there is but one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things came and through whom we live. And the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught to his disciples begins, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. As the Message version says, Our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. That's my prayer for us this morning. That's it. That we would know God. That this is where spiritual life begins, by knowing who he is. And once you know and experience him, everything else flows from there. So let's commit ourselves this week to look for God. To step away from the drama, to step away from the news, to step away from all the chatter. I promise you, it will still be there when you get back. Commit yourself to look for God. Look for him where? Well, look for him in his word. Open the word and read what it says about who God is. Look for him in nature. Open your eyes to the beauty around you. Last night, the lightning and the thunder and the rain nourishing the ground. It speaks volumes about who God is. Look for the Lord in other people as you see them. As you see the fruit of the Spirit displayed in their life, realize that fruit is fruit that comes directly from God. Look for the Lord in unexpected places. And I pray that we will begin our journey towards spiritual life by knowing God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning, for the experience of Isaiah. None of us have seen God in that way. We've not seen you in that way, O Lord. But you've given us your word so we can see it for ourselves. And I pray, O Lord, that you might give us an experience of knowing you that would change our lives, that would help us to grow spiritually closer to you. Father, I pray that all of the baggage of this last year and a half and all of the harm that has been done to us, Lord, might be healed. And Father, I pray that we begin in our spirit with catching a fresh vision of who you are. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
You find us, calling before.
Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we so desire to be well, Lord, physically, mentally, spiritually, to grow, to be strong. And so, Father, we turn to you and pray, our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.